Okay, I'm just waiting for the recording to start. Okay, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the class BC314 on media and technology and ministry. Sorry for missing the classes last week. We will definitely catch up and cover everything that we intended to cover in this course. Let's pray together before we start. Can I request somebody to pray? Thomas, God bless you. Would you like to pray, Thomas, and help us start?
Sure, Pastor.
Thank you.
Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for this wonderful day, Lord. Thank you for your mercy and grace. They are new every morning. Father, as we sit to listen from your word, Father, let the spirit of wisdom rest upon us. Help us to understand. Father, we thank you, Pastor Ashish. Anoint him. And Father, let me grow in the kingdom. We bless you. We give you glory. Let the soul will be blessed. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Good morning and welcome, everybody, to this course on media and technology in ministry. So, last week we didn't have classes. Apologize for that. The week before, we covered some of the distribution channels. We talked about the various ways in which we can distribute content online through online platforms, right? So I give you the list, and as and when your church or your ministry grows, and then you want to think about distributing content, you can consider some of those platforms. So today, what I would just I would like to like us to look at is social media platforms. Which I think many of us are familiar with and are already using some of these platforms. But I just want to touch on things that would be relevant in terms of how to use the platforms, not so much as which platforms, but some things to keep in mind as we use social media to engage with our audiences, whether it's people in the congregation or people outside the congregation. So along those lines, to share some thoughts and see if you would be interested in taking it and making use of it in your church, in your ministry. We'll do that today. I think we will be able to cover that chapter. And then from tomorrow onwards, we'll start talking about equipment. So we want to talk about the hardware and software that we use in various things that we would be doing in ministry, just to give us an exposure. When you have to make decisions, on those things, it'll be useful. But let's try and see if we can discover the usage of social media today. And these are just some guidelines to keep in mind, right? So the social media has become a big thing in people's lives today, for good or for better or for worse. It's become a big thing, and as we saw in our very first lecture, when you look at the current data, the number of hours people spend on the internet in general and social media, in one or more of these platforms, it's huge. An hour or more, and we're just talking about averages. We're not saying that every individual, but in average, on an average, people are spending several hours a day on social media on multiple platforms. So it is important for us as a church, as a Christian ministry, to say, okay, look, this is where people are, then that's where we need to go and engage with them. So we don't look at these social media platforms as taboo or bad. No, it's just where people are. And so we need to be able to very intelligently see how we can engage with people, right? Now, some churches take the position that, oh, we will not engage with social media at all. It's bad, it's a waste of time, this, that. Personally, my conviction is we don't need to take that stand. Rather, we should say that, look, this is where people are. Then let's look at ways by which we can meaningfully engage people, build relationships with people, wherever they are. And in this particular case, social media platforms. Now, some of the current platforms, of course, you know, here's again, platforms come and go. Things were there, things, platforms that were popular several years ago have disappeared, and some have stayed and endured through time. And, you know, we don't know what, you know, 6 months from today, what would be there. But some of the more stable, more, you know, well-established platforms, which we are all familiar with, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, and of course, teenagers and young people are heavy on Instagram and TikTok. And then there are other specialized type of platforms, Pinterest and Reddit. So LinkedIn, of course, it's, you know, a professional community. It's meant for, it's targeting working people, or sorry, I shouldn't say, it's more of a professional type of social platform, but it's good as a church to have a presence there, because if that's kind of the people you're looking at reaching, then it's good to be on that. So the question, I think, to begin with, is to find out for the audience that you are targeting, right? Or maybe you have a diverse audience. You know, you may be having, of course, teenagers, young adults, you may have others, you may have professionals in your audience. So you need to have some idea. Now, what are the social media platforms that people in your audience are spending time on? So that, of course, you could engage with them on those platforms, right? So if people, in example, if there are a lot of young people, teenagers, young, you know, young adults in your congregation or in your audience, so the people that you're targeting, then it's very likely they are very active on Instagram and TikTok. You may not find them on LinkedIn. You may not find them on Twitter, but you'll find them on Instagram and TikTok. You need to have a good, some idea, okay, this is where my people are. And of course, you may want to, you know, target multiple platforms, and that's okay, because, you know, in any congregation, you have different age groups and segments of people, and so you may need to do multiple platforms, but find out the ones that you feel you should focus on. And when I say research, I don't mean like heavy duty research. It's just like looking across your congregation and, you know, just getting a feel of where people are. That's enough. So what I want to just share is some, you know, some practical things on how do you engage with people on social media, because the fact is they are spending time, you know, on a daily basis, or at least on a weekly basis. People are spending time on social media. So it's good that as a church or a ministry, you have something happening where you can connect with people. How do you go about doing it? And here are some practical things. One is, it's very important to do regular posts from your church or ministry. And of course, you brand it. That means, you know, it should be your church's Facebook page or, you know, Instagram account. And it has your church logo or your church name on it. So people know that, okay, this church or this ministry is putting out this kind of content. So, and there's nothing wrong. You know, basically, as a church, you're reaching out to the community that you are interested in, or to the people that you're interested in. So there's nothing wrong that your church has a Facebook page or an Instagram account that is branded and named by your church or ministry, and it's reaching out. Nothing wrong with that. Okay. But then the key is to do regular posts. Don't do it randomly, occasionally, you know, so people don't know when you're posting. But if you do regular posts, something that has created an expectation and people are looking forward to, then that would be useful. So just some ideas, you know, for instance, some of the things that we do, and which I think almost any church can do, is we put out our Sunday sermon, the edited version of the Sunday sermon. So happens on Sunday by latest, usually by Monday, or latest by Tuesday, that edited sermon, that's just the sermon part, comes out. Then, you know, another sermon may be 45 minutes long, which is a lot of time for many people. And so they may not want a full sermon. So some people may want just the key points. So we also have a 5-minute version of the Sunday sermon. We call it Key Points, which also goes out by Monday or Tuesday. And then, of course, to the younger generation, they just want the highlight. Hey, if there were 5 key points, what was the main point? So we have a smaller version, a 60-second or less version, which is just one statement, key statement from the whole sermon. You know, so, you know, we're looking at different interest levels and availability, right? Some people don't mind listening to the whole sermon. Some people may be able to afford 5 minutes. Some people I'll give you a minute, tell me something, you know. So we are putting all of that out on, of course, it goes on all our platforms. So wherever people are engaging, they're able to get it. And this happens every week, right? Every week. So those who are interested can look forward to it on a weekly basis, right? So they know. And every Monday or every Tuesday, these things are coming out from this church, the sermon part. We also have, you know, we also announce, what we do is we announce the coming sermon, that means the coming Sunday's sermon, title and all of that, usually by Friday. Now, some people like it, some people don't like the idea. They say, why do you want to tell people? Keep it as a suspense and, you know, make them come to church. But we feel that we can let people know ahead of time what is this upcoming sermon. Sometimes it could be a guest speaker, or sometimes it's part of a sermon series, but they know what to expect. So you're already setting the expectation. And sometimes if they're thinking about inviting their friend, you know, they could decide, like, okay, yeah, this sermon title seems to be relevant for my friend, or maybe I should not invite them, whatever, you know. So we feel we are looking at it from that perspective. And so every Friday, there's a graphic that goes out that announces the title of the sermon coming Sunday. So, you know, I'm not saying you have to do it. I'm just saying, you know, this is what we do. And of course, there are other event announcements. If anything else is happening, you also announce that. Then something we started doing maybe just a year back or so is we put out testimonies that come in. Of course, these are a brief of the testimony, it's not the whole testimony. We do it anonymously. That means we don't reveal the name or any of those details. And people know that when they send a testimony, we are going to share it. So it's an implicit or implied permission. And we don't reveal anybody's names. If somebody sends a testimony, not to that particular email ID, but some other way, then we check with them. Can we share your testimony anonymous way on our platforms? And we get their permission, then do it. So these testimonies are a very good thing, which, you know, to do, because then people know that something is happening in this church or in this ministry, lives are being touched in such and such manner. And it's a good thing. And you're not doing it to promote, but you're creating awareness. And of course, you're glorifying the work of God, glorifying God. Other things that you could do is just normal pictures and videos of what's happening in the church. Yeah, just these are all just candid shots of what's going on in the church service. Sometimes you could get people to share their individual experiences. You show people volunteering and serving at an event or something, or part of the regular service. It gives the outside people a feel of, oh, this is what the church is. This is what the community is like, you know, and it lets people know. And sometimes that can actually welcome people to the church. It's like, hey, these people are just regular day-to-day people, and they're all working together, and they seem to be having a good time, and they're happy and serving God. And so it just draws people to your congregation or ministry. And of course, in cases where you need to get permission, do that. You know, if you're putting pictures of children and so on and so forth. And if you're having special events like conferences, seminars, mission trips, programs, you can put those pictures and videos, which again is a nice way to let people know what your church is about. All right, so these are just some ideas, but if you do it in a very systematic way, that means it's happening, right, regularly. That is the key. Right? Rather than doing, it happened once a month or once a year or once in a few months. If it's happening regularly, like your sermons or your other events, that is key. It keeps people engaged on those platforms. Another practical tip is when you're using social media platforms, maintain a consistent look and feel across all platforms. That means people, there is creativity, there's different expressions, but people should not get confused on what kind of a church you are. Example. So we use the word personalities, meaning if, or in one place you're making your church look as very sober, very reverent, and then in another place, it looks very unlike that. Then people get a confused message, because sometimes people may look at both platforms. I'm not saying don't be creative, but don't use different creative ideas. But what I'm saying is the look and feel, who you are, what is your church about, the message coming through must be consistent across all platforms, because people may tend to see you on multiple platforms. It should not send contrary or confusing message. So that's the point, right? So maintain a very consistent look and feel, a consistent personality or a consistent messaging across all platforms, not to confuse your audience. Okay. Another simple tip is to encourage people to share. So, sharing is like the word of mouth. So, the word of mouth is very powerful. If somebody invites a friend and says, would you like to come to church? That is more powerful than just randomly dropping invites into people's homes, telling them to come to church. Now, there's nothing wrong in sending in invitations. Somebody may come, but the word of mouth, personal invitation, is very powerful, because there is trust and there's relationship and comfort, all of that. So on social media, sharing is kind of equivalent to the word of mouth. So when you tell people in your congregation, hey, why don't you share this link with your friends? Now, of course, you don't want to force people, or you don't want to make people obligated to do it. It's just a request. you know, you just so you know, on Sundays, we tell, you know, the person who's starting the worship would say, oh, you know, you'd welcome. And then he said, hey, why don't you share the link now with somebody, invite them. Or when we're doing other posts, we say, no, please share it with others. So it's just an invitation. It's not a compulsion. But that sharing is very powerful because they would obviously share it with people who are connected to them on social media. They would share it on their timeline or some form. And it means that they are telling their friends, they're telling people in their circle of influence, hey, I like this, I'm going here, so on. So there's automatically a trust level. And this is all happening on social media. So without forcing people or without, you know, making them feel obligated, you can just encourage people. You know, why don't you share with your friends? And it's harmless. You know, you're just sharing it on your own timeline. It's a very simple thing, harmless thing to do. And most people would be happy to do that. Okay. So another useful thing, maybe more than useful, or I would say a necessary thing, is to use hashtags along with your posts on social media. So whatever you place after the hashtag is like a search keyword or a search phrase by which your content is being indexed by the search algorithm that's behind that platform. So example, on Facebook or on Instagram or any of these social media platforms, when you do your post and then you put your hashtag, usually you would do about three hashtags. Don't and different platforms have different I'm not saying standards, but recommendations on how many hashtags are optimal. So maybe on Facebook, three. On Instagram, you can go up to 30. But doesn't mean you have to put 30 hashtags. It just means you can, you know, can go up to 30. Facebook, you can put more, but just putting minimal, about three, is makes the post effective. So like that, what do you do is use these hashtags to indicate what your content is about and to generate interest in your post. If you don't use hashtag, you're missing out on making your post and content searchable and visible to other people. Right? So put some hashtags, just even three hashtags, anybody, you know, in your post. And you're indicating that it's on this topic or this category and so on. And so simple thing, you know. So basically, it's a keyword or a key phrase, and you can put it anywhere, top, middle, bottom of your text. And this is the normal way to do it, right? You don't use any space, don't use any special characters. So example, all people search Bangalore. Or you want to, you would, a better way to do it is like this, right? That you use mixed case. So it's easier to read, capitalize each individual word, but make sure there's no space, no underscore, no hyphen, no special character there, like that. So you can say, this is an online church service, so people who are interested in that can go. Or then you could use things for, related to the topic of your sermon, related to the content of your post, things like that. So what happens? That indexes that post, makes it searchable. So the people who are interested in that kind of a theme, topic, etc., they can see this, right? So it helps your content to be found by the right people who might be interested in it, and it will drive traffic to your content. So basically, you are targeting and you're making your post more visible when you add hashtags along with your post. Okay. Now, other thing on social media is to respond to questions, comments, etc. Especially questions or negative comments, concerns. Now, if people say, you know, I like this, or, you know, people may just do a like or a, you know, a positive comment. Okay, you know, you don't have to respond to it. But if people are asking questions, how do I come to church? What time is your service? Etc. Or, you know, or it's good to respond to it. Because what happens is others are watching, others are listening, are seeing, you know, how you are interacting with people. And so it kind of, in some ways, telling people that, look, I care about your questions. I care about your concerns. I care about your comments. Now, of course, I don't do this. You know, we have somebody else doing or handling this. Depending on, you know, the availability of your time, so you have to be careful. You know, you don't want to get all your time gone. I mean, especially if you're a pastor or a leader, you may not be able to spend the time responding to comments and so on. So you can assign somebody else. You know, just keep a watch on what's happening on the church Facebook page, Instagram account, or you know, whatever it's. And if there are questions, if there are comments, please respond on behalf of the church. You can delegate the work because you yourself may not have the time. But the idea is, if we are responsive to people, they'll feel comfortable. They'll feel happy that you know, the church cares about their questions and concerns, and it's a good tool for building relationships. So you're actually making use of the platform. You're building relationships. And people may, based on that, decide to even come to the church. Okay? So that's a simple thing, important thing. But it's not always easy because it requires time. And that's where maybe we should delegate it to people who can do it on behalf of the church. Another interesting thing, and this is just a thought for you to keep in mind. Is to make your posts at an optimal time. Now, why is that? First of all, why is something like that important? Because the first few hours of posting, if you get engagement, then these algorithms that are working on the social media platforms, the recommendation engines, they will begin to show your posts to more audience. Like it's almost like they recognize that people are interested in this. So let's show it to more people. So we're going a step further. It's not only about making a post, but if you can post it at an optimal time where most of your audience are online and are likely to see it or engage with the post, then it's going to increase its probability of being presented or shown to more people by the algorithms that are running behind the platform. So that is why the right time to post is useful. So depending on where you're posting, I'm not saying this always has to be, but this is just a thought to keep in mind. It's a useful thing. You know, you're thinking about when are people in my audience, your target audience, when are they most likely to be online? You know, so you'd ask questions like which day of the week and which time of day. So you want to target those kinds of things. And now in some cases, it's just a, you know, just an announcement, you post anything, okay. But sometimes if you're really interested in, you know, optimizing your views, your engagement with your post, you may look at, okay, which day of the week would most people in my audience, the people that I'm targeting, be online? Would it be a Sunday? Would it be a Saturday? Or would it be like a Thursday or a Friday? Generally, you know. Now, generally, now again, this is, I'm speaking in general terms. Generally, people say, okay, we know between Thursday to Sunday, social media engage activity goes up Thursday. Because beginning of the week, people are like, I'm getting back to, you know, I'm getting back to work, and, you know, so on. Now, some people may still be on it, but generally, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, more people are, you know, carving out some time to check on their friends or engage on social media. So, okay, so you have that window. But then what time of day? Again, generally speaking, evenings are better, right? Because mornings, nobody's going to really be on social media. They're all getting ready to work, getting ready to school. Evening, local time, I'm talking about. And if you're targeting your audience locally, yeah, that's when most of them would be taking a little time to just check on what's happening on their Facebook or Instagram or things like that. So this is a general thing. Later time, later part of the week, evenings is when most people are engaging with social media. So that's a higher, it's a better time to post. But now you need to know a little bit more specific about your own audience. Just a guess. We're not trying to just do some heavy duty research here. Just a guess. Okay. Maybe Friday evenings are better, etc. So certain kinds of posts you do it Friday evening, 8 p.m. or 7 p.m. or 8 p.m. You know, depending on when your people are most active, will be the best time to put out your post. Higher chance of engaging. That's what you're looking at, which will eventually result in more reach and more engagement. Right? Now, if you want to get a little bit technical on it, you can look at the data, the analytics. So almost all of these social media posts will give you some information. So a simple way is on Facebook, there's a insights tab or an insights page where you can go and it'll tell you, okay, you know, this is your post that's doing most well. This is when people are looking at your post, give you some data that will help you understand that, you know, this is when people are online. This is when people, these are kind of posts they like, they're engaging. So you can use that to help improve when you do your posts, right? So one is you could just have a general understanding, and that's good enough. If you want to get a little bit more data specific, you can look at the insights given, and then based on that, you can make decisions. I'm not saying this always has to be, but this is just a good thing to be aware of and to use. A few more things before we close on this is most social media platforms, they also have paid promotions and advertising, which I would definitely encourage you to use if you are promoting an event or inviting people to church and so on. You know, it's very cost effective. Even if you spend, and I'm just speaking in rupees, which is like, even if you spend 500 rupees, which is less than, you know, $1. $1.70, so less than $10. Even if you just spend 500 rupees, you can reach in your, say, within your city, within your target audience, and you want to target, let's say you want to target, you want to promote an event in your city, or you just want to invite people to your church service in your city. So what do? You create a graphic for that event or for the church service. An example, you can use Facebook and say, I'm running a paid promotion on Facebook for 1 day or 2 days or 3 days, whatever, however you want. And you just want to spend 500 rupees per day for 3 days. You can do it. And on an average, you can, you know, for 500 rupees, you can probably reach, I don't know what the number would be, but maybe like 10,000 people or more. And it's very, very cost effective. And you can do it just, you know, within a few minutes. You set the ad up, submit it, they will review it, approve it, and it's on. There's nothing, it's not too difficult. Now think about what, you know, what can you do with 500 rupees if you were going to do it physically? You would not even be able to print 10,000 handbills for 500 rupees. But using the social media platform, you're able to reach, example, 10,000 people with just 500 rupees, inviting them to church or inviting them to your event. Just a very simple thing. So using paid promotions, advertising is useful. When you target your audience, you should know what your audience are interested in, and you target them. It's a good thing to do. Okay, so keep that in mind. A few other side comments before we close is, like we said, you can see how your page is doing using the analytics information that come with most of these platforms. So on Facebook, there's an insights page where it'll show you about, you know, your people, the people who are connected to your page, and how they're doing, how your posts are doing, etc. So it's good to have a look at that from time to time, just to improve what you need to improve in using that particular platform and the posts that you're doing. Now, there are social media monitoring software. So this is advanced. Okay, so I'm not saying you have to do it, but if you want to, you know, if you really want to monitor and track what's happening to your page, to your brand, how your posts are doing, etc., in a very advanced way, there are software tools that you can go and you can say, you know, monitor my page, monitor what's happening, and you'll get your results. That'll help you on an advanced level to make improvement. So this is simple. You know, you can actually see it and see what's happening. This is something you have to set up, and it's more for advanced. The last block of information here is that I just shared, you know, so to do these posts, of course, you need graphics. You need to make it look simple. Attractive. I mean, to do some, you know, something that's simple, attractive, and so on. So I've just said a list of links, and I got this from our team. I asked them to send me this list, and these are both free and paid websites and portals from where you can get graphics, videos, fonts. So you could reuse, you know, these as part of what you do in your media work. For you can encourage either volunteers or your staff to make use of graphics, videos that are available through these. And I'm sure that there are many more, but these are what our team sent back to me, and what they use. So you could explore using these for your work, just to make your content, your posts attractive to your own audience. Okay, so that's about what I wanted to share here on social media, that if we can engage intelligently, it will be useful. Now I don't want this, I don't want, I don't want this to like consume all our time in the ministry, of course. So if you can get, ideally, it'll be nice if you get volunteers in your church, in your congregation, in ministry, and just delegate it to them and say, guys, you know, just handle the social media pages for the church and just keep you informed. And you can, of course, interact with them, give them guidance, tell them what needs to be done. And especially if you have young people, they would be more than happy to do this as part of the church's ministry. So I'm not saying that as a pastor or as a Christian leader, you should get involved in all the details. You just have an idea. Just know that these are the possibilities. These are the opportunities. These are the details that should be attended to when doing and engaging on social media. So then you can just, you know, get a team of volunteers or others to work on it. Just oversee the work. Tell them, hey, this is what we're doing. Let them come back to you on progress. And then you can share ideas on, you know, how they can take it forward on behalf of the church and the ministry. Okay. So I'm going to stop here. Let me see if there are any comments or questions from anybody on this. Any thoughts, any questions, any clarifications you would like here on this, or any more information? Everyone's okay. All right. So tomorrow we'll start talking about getting into the equipment side. Just as a way of, you know, knowledge of knowing what is used where, so that when you have people serving in your congregation or in your ministry, you'll be able to interact with them meaningfully. Okay, we're going to close and we will dismiss. Karen or Kanan, could you, either one of you, pray, close and dismiss, please. Karen, you pray and send us, please.
Yes, sir. Father, we just come before once again your throne. Father God, we want to just say thanking you, Father God, the subject. Thanking you, Father God, for your revelation and understanding and wisdom, Father God, to this subject. Thanking you, Father God. Help us to move forward, Father God. Thanking you. Almighty Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen. All right. Thank you, everyone. I'll see you again tomorrow. We have 3 hours together tomorrow. God bless. Bye now.